Okay, you just saw 90 minutes. How can you still be undecided? Please explain that to me.
Well, can I go first?
It was a disaster.
Go ahead. Kimberly, go ahead.
Well, I'm still undecided because they really didn't answer the questions that I was looking for. I really wanted to hear more in depth about race relations and the civil unrest. I also wanted to talk about, I wanted them to talk about how they were going to help the American public when it comes to COVID-19. Now, we've already had the first stimulus, but nobody really talked about, you know, how they're actually going to help the American public. They're still talking about corporations. They're still talking about the vaccine, but they're not talking about putting dollars in the pockets of the American people. So I'm still undecided.
Somebody else, why are you still undecided after 90 minutes of this debate? Somebody else, jump in. Mike.
I kind of went into this expecting to see whether or not Biden had the capacity to remain strong for the entire 90 minutes. And I think I would characterize him as having won the debate because there was no significant gap. There was no significant mistake that he made. But I still am not entirely convinced. I almost feel like I need to see another debate now just to confirm what I saw tonight in terms of Biden's ability to stand up to Trump.
Trump is annoying. He's unpresidential, at least in our definition, you know, historically of what presidential is. And he's annoying and it's like nails on a chalkboard, but him acting that way doesn't necessarily impact my bottom line. What I care about is the economy and I care about law and order. Being here in Wisconsin, having to deal with Kenosha and Madison and being afraid, you know, for my communities and seeing what happened. I've seen videos of when the federal agents were finally sent into Kenosha and there was Antifa filling up gas cans and they swarmed in unmarked cars and made me feel safe. I mean, that's what impacts me. And I liked his answer on law and order.
So Frank, give us the initial answer. I'm not saying it's necessarily the final answer. What did your focus group tell you?
Focus group told me that Chris Wallace was the winner in trying to control the two debaters, that America was the loser, quite frankly. Didn't matter whether you were supporting Joe Biden or Donald Trump. They were shocked about what was happening. They were agitated about it. They thought that neither candidate behaved well. Joe Biden telling Donald Trump to shut up. My God, that has never happened in American politics. Think about that. Or Donald Trump interrupting and not stopping. So I got to tell you that people are leaving this hall really disillusioned. My focus group was really disappointed. And I'll tell you that the coverage you're going to get tonight, other than those who are highly and unfairly partisan, is that the public was really the loser of what happened this evening.
Overall, what do you think? Hot mess, in a dumpster fire, in a train wreck, all converging?
I want to do this properly. It was described by my focus group last night as a S show, and rhymes with hit. And it was like Chris Wallace was the toilet paper trying to clean up the mess. I have never had my phone blow up. I've never had a session blow up where the participants were disappointed on both sides, where everyone was embarrassed and everyone was upset about what had happened.
I was reading yesterday, Frank Luntz, who does focus groups, did a focus group of independent, undecided voters. And the words they used to describe Trump, and I'm quoting, arrogant, crackhead, and un-American. And yes, I want to apologize to the crackheads.
And here is the man himself. He is Frank Luntz of Frank Luntz Global. Frank, great to have you with us again, as you were last night. So tell us, as you listen to these people talk, and obviously they have very different points of view, what was the overall impression you took away from what they got out of that debate last night?
Well, I was very fortunate that I had an ongoing chat, and I was in the sixth row watching the debate, and nobody could see what was going on around me. But for the entire debate, they were commenting on it. So I was able to follow their points of view as it was happening. First time anyone's ever been able to do it in a national debate. And what I found fascinating is that they started off pretty strongly for Trump. They liked the fact that he came out affirmative and strong and tough. But that wears well for maybe 15 minutes. And after 30 minutes, they get sick of it. And after 60 minutes, they absolutely hate it. Donald Trump started by really defining what he was about and by disagreeing with Joe Biden. But by the end of the debate, they were simply angry at him because he had not spent any time talking about what he was for. He spent the entire time talking about what he was against. And Joe Biden, who started the debate relatively weak, they did not appreciate that he said to the president, shut up, or that he called the president a clown. No one believes that that's deserved, even if they don't like the president. But by the end, Biden was speaking straight to the camera, as I am to you right now. And when he spoke straight to the camera, there was an emotional appeal that we couldn't feel in the hall, but they could feel at home watching him. And his appeal, mentioning the loss of his son, Beau, when Joe Biden got emotional and he talked about fighting for working class Americans, that's what the public wants to hear. That was Donald Trump in 2016. I'm going to fight for the ignored. I'm going to fight for the forgotten. I'm going to be your voice in Washington. Best line of the campaign. In 2020, Donald Trump is fighting for himself. And that's what voters don't like. My focus group that occurred within minutes of the debate finishing was pretty unanimous that they want to give the power to shut off the microphones, at least lower them, so that a candidate like Donald Trump cannot constantly talk over Joe Biden. It was a little bit done in the other direction, but it was much more Trump interrupting. They believe that whoever's the moderator should have the capability to silence them if they will not silence themselves. I know that that'll be very controversial, and that you're gonna have some issue in the Trump campaign, whether or not they would accept that. But I gotta tell you, Trump's constant interruptions were very, very bothersome to undecided swing voters, and it did turn some of them against the president. Well, I was surprised that Joe Biden didn't say bluntly at the end of the debate that there were so many lies told, and I'm not judging what Trump said. But strategically, Biden should have said, I want fact checkers on stage. I want the 85 million Americans watching to know whether these are truisms or not. And if you won't do it, I simply won't participate. And that would have been a way for him to put pressure and attention on the information that's being discussed. We've never done this before. I thought it would have been a very interesting Biden strategy.
But he couldn't have done that. I mean, he couldn't really expect that, right? Because you couldn't have 500 fact checkers checking every single line of that, because all that you would have heard about was the lies being amplified.
But that's the moderator's responsibility, is to decide when to challenge. But that's what this is about. American people want accountability, they want trust, and they want facts. So this is a legitimate concern, and the Trump people will just have to accept it.
Reaction and analysis of the debate last night from pollster Frank Luntz. Frank, thanks for being here. I know you talked to a bunch of folks last night after the debate. Tell us who they were and what they said.
It's the first time that this has ever been done in political history. We brought 15 people together via Zoom from all the swing states, undecided voters from the states that really matter. And we sat them down for about an hour and 10 minutes and asked them what they thought of the different candidates. There was a lot of disappointment, a lot of frustration. The candidates who think that they actually skirted through the frustration of the voters, they didn't.
A Republican pollster and guy drunk dialing Batman, Frank Luntz. Luntz, hi Frank, gathered 15 undecideds to respond to the debate over Zoom. Oh, please. Please, can we do the next debate over Zoom? Mr. President, I'm putting you on mute. No, don't share your screen, sir. Your tabs aren't safe for work. And Luntz, ask them this question.
Michelle, word or phrase to describe Donald Trump tonight?
Horrid.
Sarah.
Chaotic.
Rob.
Unpolished.
Ruthie.
Crackhead.
Crackhead? How dare you? Malign the good name of crackheads. Unlike Donald Trump, crackheads have a clear policy. Give me some crack.
Frank, tell us where you did this focus group and what you found. How did the voters feel after the debate?
Well, the amazing thing, and this is the first time it's ever been done, and I hope to do it again for the next three debates, if we have debates, is that we found undecided voters in eight swing states. So this was a nationwide effort. These are people who were carefully screened, and I'm still not convinced that all of them were truly undecided. But I was actually right there in the debate hall in Cleveland, and we started only 10 minutes after the debate ended. So you've got the fresh, unvarnished, unadulterated points of view of people who matter more than anyone else in this election. And what I felt afterward was real sadness, because we all who get a chance to appear on your show, we're the elite. We do this for a living, and we understand why people say what they say. Those undecided voters were crushed. They were depressed. They felt that these candidates did not give them what they were looking for. And worse yet, they thought this was an embarrassment. And the language that they used to describe both candidates, but particularly Donald Trump, I'll acknowledge that, was really harsh. Going into it, six of them had voted for Trump. Six of them had voted for Clinton. The other participants had either voted for Gary Johnson or stayed out of it. And it was really depressing what we saw, what they saw. And I guess the outcome of this is that some of them are not going to vote. They were so turned off to the political process that they're simply not to participate.